God's house this morning. I'd like to welcome our visitors who are here with us today. It's an honor that you're worshiping with us, and I pray that you would be with us again very soon. Our worship service today is Divine Service Setting 3. It begins in the front of your hymnal this morning on page 184.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord,
who made heaven and earth.
I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord.
And you forgave the iniquity of my sins.
We pause for a moment of silent reflection upon our sins. O Almighty God, merciful Father,
I, a poor miserable sinner, confess unto you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have ever offended you, and justly deserve your temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them, and I pray you for boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of your beloved Son, Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being.
Upon this your confession, I, by virtue of my office as a called and ordained servant of the Word, announce the grace of God unto all of you, and in the stead, and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ, I forgive you all of your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
We continue with the intro appointed for the day, which is printed for you on your bulletin insert.
Thank you.
from Isaiah chapter 25. On this mountain the Lord of hosts will make for all peoples a feast of rich food, a feast of well-aged wine, of rich food full of marrow, of aged wine well refined. And he will swallow up this mountain, the covering that is cast over all peoples, the veil that is spread over all nations. He will swallow up death forever, and the Lord God will wipe away tears from all faces. And the reproach of his people he will take away from all the earth, for the Lord has spoken. It will be said on that day, behold, this is our God. We have waited for him that he might save us. This is the Lord we have waited. We have waited for him. Let us be glad and rejoice in his salvation. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The epistle is from Philippians chapter 4. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again I will say rejoice. Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me. You were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for I have learned in whatever situation I am to be content. I know how to be brought low, and I know how to abound in any and every circumstance. I have learned the secret of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Let us rise to honor our Lord in the hearing of his gospel.
Sent his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner. My oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered, and everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast. But they paid no attention and went off, one to his farm, another to his business, while the rest seized his servants, treated them shamefully and killed them. The king was angry, and he sent his troops and destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Then he said to his servants, the wedding feast is ready, but those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find. And those servants went out into the roads and gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. So the wedding hall was filled with guests. But when the king came in to look at the guests, he saw there a man who had no wedding garment. And he said to him, friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment? And he was speechless. Then the king said to the attendants, bind him hand and foot, and cast him into the outer darkness, in that place where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. For many are called, but few are chosen. Here endeth the gospel. Let us confess our Christian faith in the words of the Nicene Creed, found on page 191.
I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in all things visible and invisible. And in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate, he suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again in glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
We continue with our sermon. Itself that your sins, the very sins that keep you in bondage to the self, your sins are forgiven in Christ, freely forgiven in Him, washed away in the waters of holy baptism, God. And you are clothed with His righteousness. You are a child of God. And you go forth in the freedom of that gospel, being led by the Holy Spirit to love and to serve others. And one of the great tasks that our Lord has entrusted to all of us is that we get to share this gospel and speak this gospel to those around us. And yet, as we see in the parable from our gospel lesson today, we will receive a mixed reception. The parable that we have in chapter 22 continues upon the two previous parables that Jesus has been telling. And it is a parable that has at the heart of it judgment. The judgment of God for those who would reject God, reject His gospel, reject the salvation that we have in Him, and look only to ourselves. We encounter a strange collection of individuals in this parable. We see those who are completely indifferent to the wonderful gospel that we all find and rejoice in. We find that there are others who are not just indifferent, but they're violent toward it. They seek to persecute those who would speak that gospel to them. There are those who rejoice in hearing the gospel, but we also see at the end that there are those who are hypocrites, those who wish to act as if they hear, but they ultimately do not want God as God would be given to us. They want something different than that. Now think about that. The good news of the gospel is, oddly enough, not good news to many people. Well, why would that be? How could it be that you could go forth and share the greatest news that you know of, life in Christ, abundant life in Christ, eternal life in Christ with all of the saints, and yet people would despise that news, either being indifferent toward it, or actually seek to cause you harm because of it? Well, think about this. Our entire liturgy is focused on the gospel. The mercy and forgiveness of our Lord is sung and prayed and spoken over and over and over again in the Lutheran liturgy. It is a great jewel that we have. And it is a wonderful thing that we can be bombarded with the good news of life in Christ throughout the liturgy. How do we begin, though? Think about this. How do we begin our services? After the hymn, we do what? We first state the bad news that we know to be true about all of us, about ourselves, about everyone around us. We are sinners in thought, word, and deed. We begin by confessing our sins. We begin by saying, Lord, according to your law, I see only my sin. I see that I have failed in thought, word, and deed, in all that I have done. I see that I've not kept the law, which means that the curse of the law would fall to me, that the wages of sin is death. And this is what we say before our Lord every time we gather together in the liturgy, confessing those sins. And then what happens? A beautiful thing happens. Our Lord puts in front of you a fellow sinner, called into an office that He created to speak forth His word of forgiveness to you, in the stead and by the command of my Lord Jesus Christ. I speak forth forgiveness to you. I don't offer encouragement. I don't offer assurance. Those are all good things. I proclaim to you with absolute certainty, your sins are forgiven. Why? Because God has forgiven those sins for us in Christ Jesus, because of what He has done for you and for me, going to the cross, taking your sin and in his death putting that sin to death, taking the curse of the law upon himself, taking the devil upon himself, and putting all those things to ruin for you and for me. No more sin, no more death, and no more devil, but victory in Christ. The good news, the best news. There's no greater news than that. And we rejoice and sing forth the great praises of our Lord throughout the liturgy as we continue to hear that gospel over and over and over again. So again, it is an odd thing that so many people would find that good news, that truly good news, foretold from Genesis 3 on, over and over and again by our Lord, they would be indifferent toward it or hostile toward it. Well, let's think about that, and let's look at this parable together, a judgment parable from our Lord warning his hearers and also warning you, his hearers. Matthew 22, again, Jesus spoke to them in parables, saying, "The kingdom of heaven may be compared to a king who gave a wedding feast for his son." This isn't a hard parable to understand. It is the Father who has sent his dear Son, his only begotten Son, the very Son who created the heavens and the earth, the very Son who upholds his creation by the power of his word, the very Son in whom all things find their meaning. That Son, born of the Virgin Mary, the Son of God, made Son of Man for you and me, to go to the cross, to die for our sins, to rise again for our justification. This Father has a feast, a wedding feast. It is the wonderful wedding feast of the Lamb that all the children of God yearn for and rejoice in. Well, the Father has done this for his Son, and he sends his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Take some encouragement in this. It is the Father who sends his servants. That's the prophets. That's the apostles. That's even you and me. He is the one who sends us forth as those who take his word, serving him by speaking forth the words of eternal life to those around us. But to speak that word of life, you must first speak that word of law. That word that shows us who we are. The bad news that we could rejoice in the gift of forgiveness that we have in Christ. He sends his servants to call those who were invited to the wedding feast, but they would not come. Again, he sent other servants, saying, "Tell those who are invited." Now again, look at what's going on here. Our Lord seeks out his people continuously. He sent the prophets to the children of Israel. They did not come. They did not repent and turn. He then sent more servants. Matthew 10, Jesus sends out the disciples and he says, Go to the lost sheep of Israel. Go to the children of Israel. And then what does he say in Matthew 10? He says, "Watch out. They're going to persecute you. But here's good news. Don't worry what you will say, for the Spirit of your Father will be speaking in you." Look again. Here we have in the parable other servants sent out, but this time we see something more. He tells them what to say. He tells them what to say. "Tell those who are invited, see, I have prepared my dinner, my oxen and my fat calves have been slaughtered. Everything is ready. Come to the wedding feast." Our Lord is a Lord of grace and mercy. He cares for you in all of your needs. He cares for you in ways that you cannot comprehend. He sends forth his servants over and over and over again, speaking forth a word that he gives to them, a word of life. Come come to the feast, all is prepared. When you came to this place this morning, you didn't bring anything but baggage. You didn't bring anything but disappointment and sin. But you brought these things because you knew that here, grace and mercy was to be found in our Lord. You came knowing, yes, indeed, I have failed in so many ways. But Christ covers those failures, takes them away, and in Him, I have that forgiveness and that grace and that mercy. Well, now we begin to see the reaction. They paid no attention. They heard this word. They heard this invitation. They paid no attention to it, and they went off to do what? To go to their farm, to go to their business. The treasure of this world captured them more than the treasure of eternal life. They rejoiced more in the self and in the small things they thought they could accomplish rather than in Christ and the great things He has done for us. The world was their good news. A world that passes away. A world full of disappointment. And there they placed their confidence and their hope. They went together. They paid no attention. But the others seized His servants, treated them shamefully, and killed them. This is what happened to Stephen. This is what happened to James. This is what happened to all the disciples except for John. When the disciples went forth and they spoke the truth of the gospel, they faced bitter opposition. When you speak truth, the truth of God, not your made-up truth, but the truth that God gives you, it divides people. It divides people because it says you are not sufficient in yourself. You are not your own truth, but that truth comes to us from God, delivered to us in the Scriptures, focused for us in Christ. When you speak forth that good news and the truth of God's Word, you meet opposition, not because of who you are, but because of the things that you say. Again, in Matthew 10, Jesus says, they will persecute you because you bear my name. Because you bear my name. In the early church, when it came to persecution, there were many martyrs. And the only question ever asked of these martyrs, are you a Christian? That was it. The Romans asked the one question, are you a Christian? Do you bear the name of Christ? And if so, if you said yes, you would lose your life. And the Romans persecuted those who said, I am a Christian. Jesus says, they will hate you and despise you because of my name. But when we go forth into that hostile world, we don't go forth on our own strength, our own might, our own cleverness. We go forth knowing that the very Spirit of the Father will give us the words to say and to speak forth boldly that truth. We go forth knowing that we belong to another as a child of God. The world can take nothing from us, for we have everything in Christ. Judgment comes next. The king was angry. He sent his troops and he destroyed those murderers and burned their city. Those who reject God and His Word, His deliverance, His provision, and His care are those who place their back to the very God that made them and sustains them day to day. And they will meet His justice. They've rejected His mercy, and they will see only His justice for the things that they have done. But the Father then says to the servants, the wedding feast is ready. Those invited were not worthy. Go therefore to the main roads and invite to the wedding feast as many as you find. The main roads, the highways, the byways. Go to where the people are. Go to where they are in abundance and invite them to the feast of my dear son. Speak forth my word. Proclaim the good news that all would hear and that all would then come and rejoice in the gift that they have in Christ. Those servants went out. They went out into the roads and they gathered all whom they found, both bad and good. Both bad and good. Bad and good in the eyes of the world, of course. We love to make our distinctions. We love to look around and we love to judge others. And we like to think of ourselves as a little bit better than that other guy. We always identify with the Pharisee in the temple and not the tax collector. We don't want to be like those other people. The good and the bad, the Father says. Why? Because you're not here because of any merit in yourself. You are here again because you've confessed your sins. You have repented and recognized, according to God's law, you've sinned in thought, word, and deed. You see that in Christ you have good news and forgiveness. Not because of anything that you may have brought according to the world, but because in Christ we have our plenty. The wedding hall was filled with guests. One last person. The king came in, he looked around, he saw all the guests, but there was one who had no wedding garment. And he said, "Friend, how did you get in here without a wedding garment?" And he was speechless. We saw this in the intro that we sang today. Isaiah talks about this. It's beautiful, chapter 61 in Isaiah, where the Spirit comes upon the servant, the Messiah, the one who is going to loose us from our bounds. And in him we will rejoice and exult, because in him we have the garment of salvation. We have the robe of righteousness. Yet there is one with no wedding garment. What is going on here? Well, on the one hand, this is a hypocrite, right? He wants to be around the people of God, but not on God's terms. Now, think about this rather literally. In the ancient world, if you went to a wedding, you wore a wedding garment. What is he wearing? His own garment. He doesn't want the Father's garment, which we have in the Son by the Spirit. He wants his own garment. He doesn't want Christ's righteousness. He wants his own righteousness. He doesn't want to be at the wedding on the terms of the Father. He wants to be there on his own terms. He has no wedding garment. He wishes to mingle with the people of God, but he doesn't wish to have the gifts of God in the way that God bestows them to us. Now, what would that mean, do you think? Well, it might mean he doesn't want to confess his sins, and he doesn't want to hear from a fellow sinner that his sins are forgiven. It might mean that he doesn't want to be cleansed in the humble waters of baptism. He doesn't want to receive the body and blood of Christ for his forgiveness in the ordinary bread and the wine. I think he's something like Naaman the Syrian. He's a leper, and he doesn't want to be cured by these ordinary waters from the Jordan. He wants Elisha to come out and wave his hands in the air. Do something special for me. And yet, what does God do for us? He forgives you your sins in word and sacrament, humble, ordinary means. The world never thinks highly of these gifts, and yet they are the greatest gifts that we could imagine. And so we rejoice in the robe of righteousness which we receive in holy baptism, which we receive by grace through faith, a faith that is strengthened and created and nourished in word and sacrament. We gather not as those indifferent to the gospel. We gather as those who know that the gospel is the greatest treasure that we can have, because it is indeed Christ himself that you have, and his forgiveness, and his righteousness, and his holiness. Not on our terms, but on his terms. And when we see this great gift of the gospel, we can't help but go forth, being sent by our Heavenly Father to speak forth a word of good news, pointing people to Christ, and this by the Spirit of the Father, not on our own strength. But we rejoice in that task, knowing that it may bring trouble our way. But as St. Paul so beautifully reminds us in his epistle, we rejoice. And we rejoice in the Lord. And again, we say, we rejoice in the Lord. Now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Obtain eternal life with all your saints. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Save and defend your whole church. Purchase with the precious blood of Christ. Strengthen your faithful people through the word and the holy sacraments, making them perfect in love and in all good works, and establishing in them the faith once delivered to the saints. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Guide our nation in justice and honor, that we may lead a peaceable life with integrity. Grant health and favor to all who bear office in our land, especially the President and Congress of the United States, the Governor and Legislature of our state, and to all those who make, administer, and judge our laws. Help them to serve according to your holy will. Lord, in your mercy, grant your wisdom and heavenly grace to all pastors and church workers. Especially we pray for John Jenkins, Carl Beckwith, Fred Reinhart, and the Federwicks family, that by their devoted service faith may abound and your kingdom increase. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
Sanctify our homes with your presence and bless them with joy. Keep our children in the faith of their baptism and enable their parents to bring them up in lives of faith and devotion. Remember those who have wandered from the household of faith. Work all things in their lives to remind them of their need for your grace, love, and peace. According to your will, grant that they might return to the faith and rejoice in your Son, who died and rose for them. Lord, in your mercy, by your word and Holy Spirit, comfort all who are in sorrow or need, sickness or adversity. We especially pray for Pastor Powell, for the family of Stephanie Bailey, for Pam, Kay, Willard, Linda, Cindy, Terry, Joanne, Alan, and Dorothy, and all whom we now name in our hearts. Be with those who suffer persecution for the faith. Have mercy on those for whom death draws near. Bring consolation to those in sorrow, and grant to all a measure of your love, taking them into your tender care. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayers.
all these things and whatever else you know that we need. Grant us, Father, for the sake of him who died and rose again, and now lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. We continue with the service of the sacrament found on page 194. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks unto the Lord our God. It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death in the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name, evermore praising you and saying,
thank you.
for this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy you would strengthen us through the same in faith toward you and in fervent love toward one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord be with you.
And with my spirit.
Bless we the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace.